The solar inverter is one of the most important power electronic devices that makes the modern PV system widely usable. It makes the DC power from the modules usable for all the appliances in our house. Although these appliances might internally either work with DC or AC, all of them are used to an AC grid. To know what an inverter is, we must first understand its precise function in the PV system. The output of a PV module is direct current or DC. What is meant by that? DC or direct current is the unidirectional flow of electric charge. DC is produced by power sources like batteries, laptop chargers, and solar cells. It is common to talk of quantities like DC voltage, DC power, and DC current. The symbol of DC power is this. AC, or alternating current, on the other hand, is the flow of electric charge such that it constantly reverses direction. The usual form of an AC power is a sine wave. The symbol for an AC signal is this. So why do we need AC power? After a brief war of currents in the 19th century, AC power was chosen as the standard for central power generation, transmission, and distribution. Until this day, almost all national electric grids are AC-based. Most households have what is known as the AC main sockets. Consequently, most households' electric appliances expect to be fed AC power, even though sometimes the internal circuitry of the appliances might use DC. Nevertheless, the fact remains that solar power produced needs to be converted to an AC form so that it's more usable in the electricity framework we have today. How do we make this conversion from DC solar power to easily usable AC power? By using an inverter. The inverter converts a DC electric signal into an AC one. Let's talk about the features of the solar inverter and its applications in the modern PV system. Inverters are classified based on their mode of operation, their size, or implementation topology. Let's first discuss the classification based on the mode of operation. There are inverters for grid-connected systems, one for standalone systems, and inverter that can be applied in situations that require both connection types called bimodal inverters. The first two types are the most common one used. Here, a typical grid-connected PV system is shown. The DC PV modules are connected to the regular AC electricity grid via a grid-connected inverter, sometimes called grid-tied inverter. In this case, the PV system is grid-connected. This means that the load can be supplied either by the PV system or the grid, depending on the available irradiance at the demand. The inverter latches onto the grid's frequencies and voltage. So the inverter that supplies AC power to the grid acts as a current source, while the role of the constant voltage source in the system is fulfilled by the grid. The grid-connected system topology can only be applied when there is an electricity grid available. In some places, there is no grid availability. Here we have to apply a standalone system topology. Take a look at the following diagram. Here a typical off-grid or standalone PV system is shown. Consequently, the inverter is a standalone inverter. In this case, the PV system is not connected to the grid, which means the load can only depend on the PV system for power. So the inverter that supplies AC power to the load has to appear as a voltage source with a stable voltage and frequency supplying at 230 volts AC or 110 volts AC, whichever is the standard at the location. In an off-grid system, excess energy has to be stored in order for the system to still be able to operate even at night when there is no PV power generation. Which types of storage are available And which are the most suitable for PV system applications will be discussed in the next video. Now, we already know the basic application of an inverter in the PV system. Power conversion from DC to AC. Can the inverter perform any additional function? The answer is yes. Thanks to the advances in the power electronics, it's common to have inverters that implement a maximum power point tracking or MPPT mechanism before inverting the voltage, thus ensuring that the PV modules or arrays are operating at their maximum power point or MPP. Apart from the modes of operation, inverters are also classified on basis of the implementation topology. There are four different categories under this classification. We have central inverters, which are usually around several kilowatt, 200 megawatt range. Module inverters or microinverters, typically rated around 50 to 500 watts. String inverters, typically rated around 500 watts to a few kilowatts. A string is nothing but a number of PV modules connected in series. And finally, multi-string inverters, typically rated around 1 kilowatt to 10 kilowatt range. Let's start with the central inverter. This is the most traditional inverter topology in use, as seen in this figure. This is a simple implementation with one central inverter catering to all the PV modules in a PV system. While this inverter topology increases the ease of the system design and implementation, it suffers from several drawbacks. In large system, large amounts of DC power will be transferred over long cables to reach the central inverter. This increases DC wiring cost and also decreases safety, as DC fault currents are difficult to interrupt. At maximum power point tracker, implantation inside the central inverter will only cater to the entire system as a whole. If the various module strings are mismatched, let's say due to the partial shading, the overall system output is drastically reduced. Also, the system is usually designed for a fixed power. There's a little scope for extendability of the system if more strings and more modules need to be added. Next, let's look at microinverters or module level inverters. As the name suggests, each module has a dedicated inverter with a maximum power point tracker. Therefore, the topology is more resilient to partial shading effects as compared to the central inverter topology. Clearly, the microinverters provide the highest system flexibility, since extending the size of a system under this topology is far simpler. Furthermore, the DC wiring costs are greatly reduced. However, the investment and maintenance costs tend to increase, especially if the cost per watt peak are compared. Then we have the string inverter concept, which seeks to strike a balance between the module level inverter and the central inverter topologies. The string inverter topology is more resilient to mismatch than the central inverter because each string is independently operated at its maximum power point, thus guaranteeing a higher energy yield. String inverters are smaller than the central inverters. However, the implantation is more complex than the module inverter. Also, the partial shading will have a greater influence over the string inverter topology than over the microinverter topology. Finally, multi-string inverters. This concept seeks to combine the higher energy yield of a string inverter with the lower cost of the central inverter. Each of the strings is pre-power processed using low DC-DC converters. Each string has its own maximum power point tracker implemented alongside the DC-DC converter. All the converters are connected via a DC bus to the inverter and ultimately to the grid. Within a certain power range, only a new string with a dedicated DC-DC converter has to be included to expand the system size. We now have an overview about the solar inverters and their topologies. Of course, The choice of your topology for implementation would depend entirely on the system needs, size and budget. But in general, while choosing an inverter for your PV system, what are the requirements for a good solar inverter? There are several characteristics expected from a good solar inverter. As every power processing step expends power itself, the solar inverters are expected to be as efficient as possible. This is because we wish to deliver maximum PV generated power to the load or to the grid. Typical efficiencies are in the range of more than 95% at rated conditions. Depending on the topology, it is expected that the inverters have built-in maximum power point trackers. Grid-tied inverters are expected to have active Icelanding detection capabilities. Icelanding refers to the situation in which the inverters in a grid-tied setup continue to power the system even though the power from the grid operator has been restricted. Due to safety issues, Icelanding needs to be prevented. Therefore, inverters are expected to detect and respond by immediately stopping from introducing power into the grid. This is also referred to as anti-Icelanding. Since in a lot of situations the solar inverters are exposed to ambient condition, they must comply with the temperature and humidity conditions of the location. Since grid-tied inverters pump power into the grid, they are expected to maintain very high quality so as to not corrupt the power flow in the grid. Thus, inverters are expected to have very low harmonic content on the line currents. It is a work in progress to increase the lifespan of the inverter, the crucial power electronic device in the modern PV system. A good inverter will probably reach, under favorable conditions, around 10 to 12 years of lifetime. This is a bottleneck in the modern PV system's lifetime, especially considering the fact that PV modules can last over 25 years. So now you know what an inverter is, what it does, and how it can be applied in different system topologies. The following exercise will make you further understand the inverter.